Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to the second part in this video series where I'm taking another look at the Panasonic Lumix FZ80-82 camera. If you're a new viewer here, thanks very much for stopping by to check out this video, and at the end of the video please do click that subscribe button and the bell notification icon and you'll find out when I upload part 3 in this series. Well, first of all, before we start today's video, I'd like to pick up on some of the comments from the first of this series. As you had made some comments there, thanks very much for doing so. Now, it would appear that quite a few of you are still getting some bad image quality from the FZ80 or 82 camera. It's probably due to the fact that you're not understanding the limitations of this particular camera. I went through some of them in part 1 and I'm going to go over them again in part 2 so you fully understand why this camera will produce some bad images in certain lighting or situations. There was another question posed, why haven't I done any bird in flight or sports or action type photography tutorials with this camera? Well, the simple reason is I don't think this camera is really suited to that type of photography, and neither are most of the bridge cameras in the Panasonic range. The simple reason is they are contrast detect autofocus, which is particularly bad at trying to get focus on moving subjects. In bright light, you might get a chance of getting some shots in burst mode and getting a few out of that sequence that are in focus. But if you go indoors, trying to shoot something like basketball or netball indoors, you'll find that the camera just can't focus quickly enough or stay locked on focus during those action events. You need a camera with a much larger aperture at the focal length that you'll be using, and you'll need something like phase detect. So that puts you down to some of the mirrorless or DSLR cameras to be able to pick up that sort of sports type photography. So that's the reason why I haven't done anything on these cameras. It would be too hit and miss as to whether we got any good shots to produce for the video. Well, in today's video I want to show you again how to set up this camera to give you some better images, but more importantly what to look for when you're going to shoot your image as to how it's going to turn out in your final composition. There are three things which affect the exposure in photography. They're loosely referred to as the exposure triangle, and we all use the exposure triangle to try and teach the relationship of aperture, shutter speed and ISO. It's a fundamentally flawed equation to begin with, but for beginners it's an ideal way of explaining how ISO and shutter speed and aperture work together to produce an exposure. But the ISO part of it is fundamentally flawed, but for this reason we're going to continue with the standard definition, where exposure consists of the three components of shutter speed, ISO and aperture. Now, we know this camera has a restricted aperture range, especially when you zoom into the full 1200mm or x60 zoom. You're working on between f5.9 and f8. Now, the first thing is you don't want to be using anywhere near f8 because you'll get a softening of the image due to what's called diffraction limiting. Now, on screen now, you can see what the camera did when it was left to its own devices and shot this picture at f8. Compare that to when I took control of the camera and made the exposure at f3.2, and you can see the difference. There's much more sharpness and detail in the one where I set 3.2 than where the camera selected f8. So in that f8 picture you can see the softening that's taking place in that particular exposure. Now, the camera's more likely to make some of these bad choices when you're in the fully automatic mode than when you take control yourself. Even if you don't take anything from these video series at all, at least come off the automatic mode and go into the P mode. If you look at the two pictures on screen now, the first one is taken in the fully automatic mode. Now, it doesn't look too bad, but if you compare that to one that I shot in the P mode, you see there's a lot more definition in that picture, more contrast, more saturation. It's a sharper image and it's less noisy. For the reason is that I can set some of the parameters in what we call the photo styles of the camera to give you some better results. So in the P mode you can tailor those parameters to your own individual needs, and I'll be showing you how to do that in part 3 of this video series. Now, another thing you've probably heard is that as you increase the ISO with the camera you start to get more noise in the image, and that's largely true. Now, if you look at some tutorials, you'll find that ISO has been incorrectly defined. Some people say that it increases the sensitivity of the sensor. Well, that's totally incorrect. The sensor has a fixed base or natural sensitivity, and that is the one that we should normally use. If we apply what's called ISO or gain, we actually boost that signal coming from the sensor or the photosites on that sensor We boost the amplification so it can be digitized in the correct levels that we want for our picture. So by adding amplification, we also amplify the noise, both the electronic noise coming from the signal and the image noise that we're creating in camera. So you get a lot more noise as you increase the ISO. I'll now show you a series of images that I captured this morning with my FZ80-82 on the tabletop of this trio of little ornaments, using a standard studio light just to give me a consistent light source. Started with the lowest or natural ISO of 80 and then went up to the maximum ISO of 3200. Now, as I increased the ISO from 80 through 200, through 400, through 800, you'll see that the noise is increasing in the image and the image quality is deteriorating. You're probably okay up to ISO 400, but beyond that, you are going to start getting some softening of the image due to the noise that's being amplified in the system as well. And you see that degradation in image quality. So at ISO 80, you can get some really nice images. And in most lighting situations, you can get some exposures at ISO 80. Now, outdoors, even in overcast situations, it's normally not hard to get images with ISO 80 with this camera. So you can keep that ISO down to 80 and get some very good photographs with this camera. If we look at the one on screen now, it's a natural light photography. It's taken outdoors, it's a landscape. It's with the camera set to the 20mm widest angle position and with ISO 80. And you can see there's plenty of gradation in that picture, plenty of detail, and it's a really good photograph in my opinion. You can also use it for close-up pictures as well. Providing you've got enough light, you can still use ISO 80 to give you some great definition in your images, as you can see on the screen with this picture of this blue plant. When you go into low light levels, consider ISO 400 to be your absolute maximum. If you've got to go beyond that, then it's probably worth investing in some additional light or even using off-camera flash to increase the amount of light you've got on your subject. Otherwise, you'll see image degradation. If you compare that first image that where the plant was taken in open shade, you can see the difference to the one taken in full shade, where I've had to use a higher ISO to capture the image. Now, in part one, we also considered the fact that if you're shooting at times 60 zoom or 1200mm effective focal length, you notice that sometimes shooting across land or across water, you get a lot of heat haze or water haze, which destroys the image quality. Now, the shot you're seeing on screen now was taken early in the morning, before it even started to get into the teens in terms of temperature. It was about 8 or 9 degrees. But the people on the pike there, you can see, are totally degraded because of the heat rising from the earth. It's all right if you're using this at shorter working distances, but nothing like this over a mile distance. Are you going to get any good image quality? Now, it's not down to this particular type of camera. Even if you had a £3,000 camera and lens setup, you would still see the same problems because of the physics of capturing light through heat haze or water haze. Now, the fact that this camera supports 20 to 1200mm effective focal length doesn't mean to say that you have to use that entire range. I find that if I use more than 800mm with this camera, the lens quality begins to soften a little bit. So not only are you running into problems of diffraction because of the smaller aperture with that sort of range, the lens softening compounds this and you get much softer images. I find that if I use 600mm and I want to isolate plants against the background, I get some good images, as you can see on screen now, of this common bistwort with a little insect crawling up it. That was taken about 1.5 meters away, 600mm, and it's around about f5.6, and you're getting some pretty good pictures. Now, if your subject will allow you to get closer, then if you drop down to about 150mm and you're getting down to something like f3.2, you do get some really nice sharp pictures from this camera, as you can see in this second image. Now, I did say in part one we'd look at shooting with the RAW camera file format with this camera. Now, the RAW file is basically just the sensor data, which is then saved as a file structure, which then can be imported into another program, which can decode that into an image format. So the file itself doesn't contain any image data. It has to be interpreted by a RAW converter to allow us to see an image. Now, as an experiment on my Facebook page, I took an image that I shot with this camera using the RAW and combined JPEG format. So I processed the RAW to the best of my ability and just took the outer camera JPEG and I posted the images side by side and asked my viewers to tell me which one they liked and the reasons why. Now, the one on the left, which is in fact the JPEG image, the majority of people preferred that. It appeared sharper, more contrasty and more definition, especially in the highlights of the hair of that doll. Now the one on the right is the processed RAW file. I tried as much as I could to try and get those highlights, but I couldn't get them the way that the camera had it. So the differences in natural RAW converters, it depends which you use. That was Photoshop CC 2020 version. There are other RAW converters which I haven't tried yet to see if I can actually get some of those highlights, but with the JPEG out of camera, the highlights are there and you can see detail in the highlights. So the way I've set my JPEG photo styles is ideal for the way I want to shoot. Now, JPEG processing is automatically done by the camera from that RAW file that's captured. And it's how you set up those photo styles that creates that JPEG image. Now, when you capture a RAW file, it's captured in the full 4:3 aspect ratio. You have to crop it down. Say if you wanted 16:9, you'd have to crop that in post-process anyway. Where the JPEG, if you set to 16:9, gives you a 16:9 JPEG out of the camera. So that's an advantage if you don't have to go through all the process of cropping your images to the file format you want afterwards. Now, another issue with the RAW converter is the amount of time you have to spend to try and get the image quality you want. Now, there is a program called Photolemur, and I'm going to put a link to that in video description below. It is a full-blown program. It's not a trial program, so you will be able to use it and output images without watermarking. Now, with that program, it's a simple one-click operation. You just open the file in Photolemur, it does its process and shows you the result on screen with a slider where you can actually see the before and after results. Now, if the after results are a little bit too strong for you, there's a slider you can actually adjust to bring the intensity back to where you like it to be. So it's fully customizable. Additionally, there are some styles available in the program. If you just click the little icon over the left-hand side, and that gives you the option to change the way your final output looks as well. I'll look at that in more detail in part 3, where we'll look at some more processing features, especially in the photo styles, so you can set them up to the way you want them to be in your particular type of photography. They are personal settings. What works for one doesn't work for another. What looks great to some people looks poor to others. So it's really one man's meat is another man's poison syndrome with these particular photo styles. But I'll show you how I set mine up and how you can get some fairly decent results. Well, that's it for part 2 of this series. Hope you're finding some of the tips I'm giving you useful and help you get some better images out of this camera. Of course, if you are a new viewer, please do click that subscribe button and the bell notification icon so you'll be advised when I upload part 3. And also check out my photographic blog, and I'm going to put a link to that in the video description below. You'll find lots more information on bridge cameras and mirrorless system cameras as well. So hopefully in a couple of days time, I'll see you to process RAW files in camera to be able to set up those photo styles to the way you want. And we'll also look at that Photolemur one-click RAW converter file program. So until then, thanks again for watching. Please do take care, and I hope to see you all in the next one. Goodbye for now.